Hello, my name is Arnaud Delorme, and this is a series on independent component analysis applied to EEG time series about the EEGLAB software. And this is part 5 on source localization of ICA components. So what is ICA localization of components? So we have our electrodes, and then we use ICA, we get our components, and components we get both time series and scalp topographies, as we've talked before. With the scalp topography, we can then do source localization. And here I show two different types of source localization. We can use dipoles, which are simple source point light in the brain. And we can use also distributed source reconstruction, such as Loretta. So that's what's shown on the right. And this is using the DipFit plugin of EEGLAB. So if you imagine one neuron in the brain, a pyramidal neuron, this model can be modeled as a dipole. So it has a plus and a minus polarity, and then there's electric fields. And if you have many of these neurons, the electric field can be summed up and seen at the surface of the scalp. So that's the schematic representation of what might be happening with source-like dipoles. And when we apply that to ICA, so this is ICA scalp topography, and we can see that this one should be possibly modeled using a dipole in this region, and this other one should be possibly modeled with a dipole of opposite polarity in this region, and we can project these back inside the brain. And this is, of course, a very rudimentary method for localizing ICA components, but it's very useful because we can assess the biological plausibility of these components. So here ICA created spatial filter for each temporary independent source brain sources. So to do this, we need to compute residual variance. So on the left here, we have the actual data. On the right, we have the dipole projection. And what we're going to do to see if the ICA component can be modeled using a single dipole, we're going to subtract the two map and see what's left. And basically that's called the residual variance. If the fit is really good, the residual variance is very low. It's a number between 0 and 100% or 0 and 1. And if it's really bad, it means the residual variance is very high. And we try to see what happens when we use a lot of ICA components, when we use ICA decomposition. Are these components dipolar or not? So here we did a relatively systematic study with 13 subjects, 71 electrodes, and we had a lot of data for this study. We had 300,000 data points per subject. We tested also different ICA decomposition to see if one was performing better than the others. And that's what I'm going to explain in these next slides. And we localized these components and then we computed the residual variance as I just showed you. That's the publication here on the bottom. These are the ICA algorithms we tested, and a lot of them were in EEG lab, some of them were in ICA lab, some of them were we just downloaded on the internet. We also tested other algorithms which are at the bottom, which is such as principal decomposition, PCA, principal component analysis. We tested also ProMax and whitening sphering, which are not really blind source separation algorithm, but which are still linear decomposition. These are examples of what we call good and bad components. So you see at the top, the scalp topography can be has 1% residual variance. So it means that the dipole, the single equivalent dipole, model 99% of the explain 99% of the scalp topography for these components. Then we have one with 2%, 4%, 8%, 16%, 32%, 64%, 84%. And we can see that as we reach 84%, the component scalp topography, they look like checkerboard. So they can't really be modeled using a single dipole. So that's why the residual variance is very high. And this is one of the main results of the paper. So here we've plotted every single line is a different ICA algorithm. And we plotted on one axis the dipole residual variance, and on the other axis the percentage of ICA component cumulated. So for example, if we take this point here, For the algorithm AMICA, it means that at 10% residual variance, I have 50% of my components. 50% of my components, this is across all the 13 subjects, have less than 10% residual variance. And the other algorithm, they don't perform as well in the sense that they don't have as many dipolar components. Two curves also are interesting here. The PCA curve, the principal component analysis, you can see that it's on the bottom, except for the first and maybe the second PCA components, or the other ones, they look like checkerboard. So they can't really be modeled using single sources. We also have to, the other dotted line is the raw EEG. So when we sample the raw EEG as at random latency, we can see how it looks like. And so basically it's not as dipolar as the ICA components. It doesn't mean that because you're on top of the curve, you're necessarily doing better. There's some caveat, for which we explained in the paper, about whitening, for example. So I invite you to read the paper if you're interested in that. What we're interested in seeing is that how is this correlated with whether the ICA algorithm performs well or not on the data. And for this, what we did is that we set thresholds or residual variance. I'm going to show you a curve where we set the threshold at 5%, but we also try different thresholds, 10%, 15%, etc. And basically that allows us to compare on at one specific threshold the different ICA algorithm. So to assess if the ICA algorithm are performing well, we use two measures. That's the first one. Here is the mutual information reduction. And all these math I'm going to show you here and try to explain to you, they were derived by Jason Palmer in our paper. And basically you have the entropy, so the joint entropy of Y, which is the ICA decomposition, is equal the log of the determinant of the weight matrix, so that's the ICA weight matrix, plus the entropy of X, which are the channel. If we looked at the mutual information of the ICA components, so we can decompose that. That's the standard decomposition of mutual information, which is the univariate entropy of every single component minus the joint entropy of all the components. And if we replace the entropy of all the joint entropy of all the components with the log determinant of plus the entropy of X, this is the bottom equation is the one we get. It becomes interesting when we look at this measure. So this measure is the mutual information reduction. We start from the channel space, we end up in the component space. How much did we, were we able to reduce information? So we subtract the mutual information of X channels minus the mutual information of the components. And what we get is that we just use the formula above, and here are highlighted. Basically, we get the mutual information of the channels minus the mutual information of the components. And what's very interesting here is that the part that's really hard to calculate, which is the joint entropy of the channel. So the part that's really hard to calculate here cancels out. And what's left is the log, the determinant of the weight matrix, which is relatively easy to calculate, as well as univariate entropies here on the bottom, which are also easy to calculate. If you have the probability distribution of the channels and the components, you can easily calculate these measures. So we can calculate mutual information reduction for every single ICA decomposition. And we plotted that against, you remember I said we've set a threshold at 5%, and we plotted that against the number of ICA components which are dipolar at 5%. And this is what the curve shows. And basically, more independence, the better the ICA decomposition at optimizing independence, the more the biological the components are. So this was the main result of that paper. The fact that this relationship is linear from our perspective relatively by chance, because there is no real connection between these two measures. One is about the statistics of the data, mutual information reduction, and another one is the biophysical model. So that's one measure, and Well, can we try another one? So we tried another one. We tried the pairwise mutual information. So this measure doesn't take into account all the higher order entropy between components. It's just taking into order the second order entropy. As you can see, mutual information between two components is the entropy of the first one plus the entropy of the second one minus the joint entropy. And as I mentioned in one of the previous lecture, this joint entropy is relatively easy to calculate. This is a contingency table here for two variables. We had stress and emotions, and I explain how you can use Shannon formula by just summing over the probability in each cell times the log of the probability in each cell to get a measure for the joint entropy. So this is perfectly doable. When we get to three variables, four variables, calculating the joint entropy becomes impossible. Here we have 72. We have 72 ICA decomposition. So the mutual information reduction before was taken care of that. But this is an interesting, relatively independent measures. And so this is what we get here. So the remaining pairwise mutual information, when we have lower values, we have more dipolar components. And against the AMICA algorithms and other ICA algorithm we use in the EEG lab, like Infomax, we're on the left side of the curve, which means that their components were more dipolar and they had less remaining pairwise mutual information. The color here are added by hand. They indicate family of algorithm. So again, this shows basically something very similar when we're using the mutual information reduction. So these are two independent look at the data, which confirm that IC algorithms which are more efficient tend to return more dipolar component. So how do these components look like? So these are seven classes of ICA components. We have alpha rhythm, and on top we have the spectrum. On the bottom we have the scalp topography of these components. We have frontal midline theta, we have a blink components, we have a left mu rhythm components, we have a right mu rhythm component, we have lateral eye movements, and we have EMG components. And we look, do the scalp topography look the same across ICA decomposition, or do they look very different? And basically they look almost the same in the different ICA decomposition. So that's what's shown here. And I'm going to show you a quantified graphic. So on top, the image represents the scalp topography correlation, which I just showed you the scalp topography. And the bottom represents the time activity correlation. Are the time activity also correlated, or just the scalp topography? And we use basically AMICA as the, so we correlated everything with AMICA because it was performing the best. And on the bottom here, we see the information reduction difference with AMICA, and we can see, and we ordered the algorithm. And we can see that most algorithms are very close to AMICA. And so here on the bottom, we can see the algorithm which didn't work well. So we have sphering. Sphering is basically the correlation of the data. And all of these algorithms didn't work well. And the reason we think they didn't work well is because a lot of these algorithms were developed with toy data. They're trying to separate one or two components and also on 1,000 data points. This is a much different problem. There's 71 components to work with, and also 300,000 data points. So maybe the parameter for these algorithms was not optimized. And so I want to thank you for your attention, and I'll see you on the next video.